Today we'll be looking at the subject covenant living, but from the context specifically of sacrifice. Praise God. Sacrifice. Amen. First of all, let's look at the subject of covenant briefly. What is a covenant? A covenant is an agreement. Now, I'm saying this definition is from a biblical standpoint. Praise God. A covenant is an agreement between God and his people, in which God makes promises to his people and usually requires certain conduct from them. A covenant is an agreement between God and his people in which God makes promises to his people and usually requires a certain conduct from them. Amen. Come look at Psalm 50, verse 5. Psalms 50, verse 5. Quickly. It says, gather my saints together to me, those who have made a covenant with me by what? Come on, church. Gather my saints together to me, those who have made a covenant with me by what? Now, why is God asking his people to come together, but not just everyone, but specifically to those who have made a covenant with him by sacrifice? Which means that there are some saints who actually have not gone to that extent of making a covenant with him by sacrifice. So it makes us realize that there's something about this sacrifice you'll be seeing in a minute that God honors and respects. Praise God. A covenant is an agreement. It's a binding agreement. Scripture says that my covenant will I not break, nor alter the things that have gone out of my lips. So the covenant that you have with God will activate certain supernatural possibilities upon your life that God would have to keep his own side of the bargain, just as you keep your own side. But throughout the Bible, we see a recurring word when it comes to God dealing with people and stepping into the affairs of men, even other deities as well, as you already know, that word is sacrifice. Sacrifice is a law. It is something that has great value in the realm of the spirit. To be quite frank, it has the ability of changing a natural outcome. It has the ability of changing a predictable outcome, which means if 1 + 1 = 2, we all know that it equals 2. But when 1 + sacrifice adds to 1, that result called 2 will actually have to change. Praise God. Have you ever wondered why? When you go to, I'm sure many of us, especially if you've watched Nollywood movies for some time, even now, if you watch some movies from the Western world, you see a lot of that sacrifice. You meet somebody who you feel has the capacity to change your reality, and you inquire of him to say, this is what I need done. We call him Native Doctor, Dibia, whatever. This is a reality that I want to change. And the first thing he says is that this is what you must do, which is usually an extra mile of something that you would have been willing to do. Is anybody hearing what I'm saying? And so it means that there is something about this sacrifice that allows man to draw from another realm. Are you getting what I'm saying? What then is sacrifice? Sacrifice is something of great value that you give up for the sake of another, either as a show of love or as a medium of acquisition. It is something of great value that you give up for the sake of something, either as a show of love or as a means of acquisition. So which means that there are two aspects of sacrifice, two aspects of sacrifice. One is as a demonstration of your love and passion for something. And two, as a means of acquiring something that is naturally beyond your reach. Praise God. The first, being that John 3:16 says, for God so loved the world, he could have just loved the world and tell you that, I love you. But you see, one of the ways that in this dispensation, we are sure it has been proven to us that truly he loves us is because he gave not just his son, not just any son. He gave his only begotten son. Are you getting what I'm saying? So he demonstrated his love to us by sacrifice. So we know that sacrifice is actually a way to prove your love for God. And I'd like us to look quickly. Genesis chapter 22. You see, when God demands sacrifice from men, it's not actually to reduce you. It's not to make you shed your belonging. It's not to make you to reduce a part of your value. No. No. You will see shortly that God actually demands sacrifice sometimes from men for many reasons. One of the reasons would be for you to prove to him your level of allegiance. Prove to him your level of love and honor. He would demand it. He would demand it. Man in his natural state is selfish. So it means that you can actually do something sacrificial. Anytime you do something sacrificial, you invite an unseen being to that location. Because it's not within the willpower of man to take certain sacrificial steps. And that's why Solomon would offer 1,000 burnt offerings unto God. And in the evening, God would do what? Visit him. Because what he did, it was beyond the natural ability of a man. And let me tell you this. You see, it's easy to sacrifice something you did not work for. But if you worked for it, if there was effort involved in it, it's very hard to sacrifice. Very hard. And if God will come for anything that's in your possession, for you to prove your love for him, it's definitely going to be something that will be very hard for you to release. Why? Because occasionally he will come to demand that thing for you to prove that he is still your God. Let me quickly tell you, anything you are unwilling, you do not have the capacity to sacrifice, is bigger than you. Anything that you do not have the willing to let, you do not have the willpower to let go, has actually become an idol to you. Praise God. You see, when you gave your life to Christ, what did you say? That you were giving him your what? Your what? Your life. Abi? How many of you are born again here? Yes. So you came before God and said that, I offer my life to you. Right? Now, how come there is a part of your life that you cannot offer if you truly offered the whole life to him? So when God demands sacrifice from you, he wants you to go beyond the lyrics. You are poetic. You are very skillful with words to declare. When it's time to sing of your love for God, You sing. And you are, sometimes you even cry when you sing. Your soul is touched by the lyrics of that song. And you declare your love for him. And then he makes a demand. And you say, that's the voice of the devil. Every single person, now mark my words, every single person that claims to be a child of God, at one point in order, at multiple points in your life, you'll be required to drop something of great value. You will. You will sense it. You can be in a gathering like this, and then just the way I was announcing outreach, the Lord will tell you, you see that 150,000 in your account? Send 145,000. Ah! And you say, the devil is weak. You want to make me poor. You want to make me suffer. No. God does not demand sacrifices from men to reduce them. Rather, he is giving them an opportunity to actually invite him into their situation to change it. I'll show you in scripture now. Genesis 22 from verse 1. We would try our best to read as quickly as possible. Now it came to pass after these things that God tested Abraham. Somebody say, God tested Abraham. And said to him, Abraham. And he said, here I am. Next verse. Then he said, take now your son, your only son Isaac. Now, just in case Abraham was thinking wild, was thinking about a spiritual son, was thinking about one of those young men that he was training in his house that called him father. So God wanted to clarify the particular son that I am in need of. He said, your only son, Isaac, the one he waited for 25 years for. Let me tell you, you will never understand the position of Abraham if you've not had to wait that long for something so there. Abraham waited for 25 years. Scripture says that he was dead. Do you know what I mean? Are you sure you know? You know, when the Bible says that a man is dead, not dead as in dead, which means that even when he wants to do that which would cause him to produce that child, he cannot. Biologically speaking, he was already dead. So at that point in time, he had lost hope completely. There was no hope that he could ever have the opportunity of fathering a child from his union with Sarah. And so after the promise came, Isaac was his child of promise. Someone that he waited so long for, but eventually came. The same God. You see, let me tell you, one of the reasons why you would struggle to give God anything is because you actually think it did not come from him. If you knew it came from him, you would be very quick to give it back to him. Because you know that from that place that it came, more can come. Are you getting what I'm saying? And so he said that your only son Isaac, whom you love, and go to the land of Moriah and offer him there as a burnt offering on one of the mountains of which I shall tell you. Let me tell you, the difference between this sacrifice and the sacrifice that Anna gave. You know, Anna gave Samuel a sacrifice, but she didn't give him as burnt offering, which means that she could stroll to Eli's house and say, Samuel, how are you? Now, this sacrifice is that. Have you seen Suya before? He didn't say, ask somebody to do it. He said, you, go and offer Isaac. Use your hand as a burnt offering. Look at it. On one of the mountains of which I shall tell you. Next verse. So Abraham rose early in the morning and saddled his donkey and took two of his young men with him and Isaac his son, and he split the wood for the burnt offering, and arose and went to the place of which God had told him. Now, if you were Isaac, what kind of journey do you think that would have been? You are used to your father making sacrifices. All of a sudden, you see the servant, you see wood, you see everything. But in the usual practice, you see an animal. Not knowing that you are that animal. So Abraham rose early. Next verse. Then on the third day, Abraham lifted his eyes and saw the place afar off. And Abraham said to his young men, stay here with the donkey, the lad, and I will and I will go yonder and worship, and we will come back to you. Next verse. So Abraham took the wood of the burnt offering and laid it on Isaac his son, and he took the fire in his hand and a knife, and the two of them went together. So at this point in time, he had asked the two servants, people who accompanied them, to wait while him and the sacrifice can now go to the mountain. Are you getting what I'm saying? So Abraham took the wood. But Isaac spoke to Abraham, his father, and said, "My father." And he said, "Here I am." Now, this is to tell you that Isaac had come of age that he could actually look his father in the eye. He understood what time it was. He could look his father in the eye and have a reasonable conversation. You know, if it was just a baby who didn't know anything, number one, you have not had time to bond with that child. You have not established a relationship with that child. But this time around, it was someone who had grown up to the point that he knew what was actually happening. Are you getting what I'm saying? I'm trying to explain to you the depth of this scenario. How deep it was. And he said, "My father." And he said, "Here I am, my son." Then he said, "Look, the fire and the wood. But where is the lamb for a burnt offering?" Next verse. And Abraham said, "My son, God will provide for himself the lamb for a burnt offering." Let me tell you, this was a statement of faith. Usually, I've heard it preached several times that Abraham knew God so much that he knew that God would not allow him to kill his child. It's not actually true. It's not correct. He just could not stand. How would he look his son in the eye and say, "You are the sacrifice"? How? How? If you were the one, how will you do it? So the two of them went together. Next verse. Then they came to a place of which God had told them. And Abraham built an altar there and placed the wood in order. And he bound Isaac his son and laid him on the altar upon the wood. The Bible did not say he closed his mouth. I can imagine while Isaac was bound like that, Isaac was saying, "Daddy, father, me, what have I done? Is your God so wicked? Daddy, why?" And Abraham stretched out his hand and took the knife to do what? He took the knife to do what? The Bible did not say he took the knife to test whether God was serious about his demand. See, he was willing to go all the way. All the way he was willing. Yes, this is the child of promise. Yes, I know that I waited for this child. Yes, I know that when I left my father's house, they thought I was stupid. And so now, finally, I have a proof to say, "Oh, actually, I'm not that barren. Oh, it's truly God that. Now, this proof that I have, this evidence, you are about to take it from my hand." But he was not actually trying to slay Isaac to test whether God. No, he took the knife to actually slay him. Because as strong as Abraham was concerned, his obedience was complete. This is someone that had given his life to God. So whether he perished, he did not care. The only one that he was sure that he served and had trust in was the Almighty God. And so he was willing to do whatever it takes to prove his allegiance and his obedience to God. Even if it took him offering his only son, according to scripture, the one that he loved, the child of promise. But the angel of the Lord called to him from heaven and said, "Abraham, Abraham." So he said, "Here I am." And he said, "Do not lay your hand on the lad or do anything to him. For now I know that you fear God." Now let me tell you this. This verse actually bothered me for a long time. "Sir, you told me to go and sacrifice my son." I said, "Okay." At that point, you did not know that I love you. I said, "Okay" to you, which means I agreed. At that point, you should have said, "You are really agreed. Oh, you really love me." No. I took this boy on a journey that took days. Nowhere along the line did you tell me that, "You have made the effort. I see that you love me." We reached a point, you allowed me to have that conversation with him where he asked me, "I see the wood, I see the fire. Where is the sacrifice?" Do you know what it means as a father? At that point, you didn't tell me that now I know you love me. He told him at the point where he was actually going to slay him. God needed to be sure that this is what he was not trying to scam him. If the voice of God did not come speedily, that knife would have come down. That is how much Abraham was willing to show God. And he said there, now I know that you do what? Since you have not withheld your son, your only son from me, what are you withholding from God? What is so dear to you that you cannot let go? What is so dear to you that has risen and become a God to the point that you know you cannot sacrifice a God to a God? If you cannot sacrifice it, then it's a God. When we talk about idolatry, many times people look at going to the village and no. These days, there are many idols. Sometimes the Lord prompts you to sacrifice just so that you can get rid of an idol or to bring your attention to the issue of an idol in your life. He wants to be your only God. And so at this point, he said, now I know that you fear me. Since you have not withheld your son, your only son from me, I can hear Abraham saying in my heart, actually, he's not my son. He's your son. You gave it to me. Scripture says that, what is it that you have not received? Is anybody hearing what I'm saying this morning? Hey, what is it that you have that you cannot receive? Sometimes we have now, I say jokingly many times, we practice Christianity of bread and butter. The Lord will bless you. Amen. The Lord will bless. First of all, do you know that the blessings of God is actually not money? Eh? Do you know? When you talk about blessing, you say, the Lord bless you. Some of you actually think in the context of, somebody will credit my account. No, that's not what. The Bible says that the blessings of God make it rich. So it's not rich itself. It's not the money itself. But it make it rich. It has the capacity for you to attract wealth. But it's not wealth. If all you seek from God is money, you don't need God. Even the devil can give you money. There's a spirit called the spirit of mammon. Have you not read your Bible? When the devil took Jesus to the mountain and said that if you would just bow to me, small bow, you don't even need to, just bow small, I will give you. Next verse. Then Abraham lifted his eyes and looked, and there behind him was a ram caught in the thicket by its horns. So Abraham went and took the ram and offered it up for a burnt offering instead of his son. Next verse. And Abraham called the name of the place, the Lord will provide. Now, you know, when we read this, the first time I read this, it didn't really mean much. You know how we say Jehovah Jireh, right? It didn't mean much. But you see, when you were just about to sacrifice your only, it meant so much to him, because God meant so much to him, so much more to him, that he had to give to God that which actually cost him a lot. And so at this point, this provision was not just any other provision. It was a provision that actually, did you ask yourself, what will he tell Sarah when he gets home? As he comes back home, Sarah says, my Lord. You know, at that time, they used to say, my Lord, did you send Isaac somewhere? He said, no. So what happened? The child that I was barren for, I stayed 25 years with you. I even offered my maid so that you will go and do one or two. You sacrifice what? It is then you will hear. It's not two of us God called. It's only you. So this one belongs to two of us. So you cannot sacrifice. Next verse. Then the angel of the Lord called to Abraham a second time out of heaven and said, by myself I have sworn. Did you see this? See, let me tell you this. There are different levels of relationship with God. There is a level, this one It's not very common in scripture for you to see God swear. Because there is nothing above him, he had to swear with his own name. He said, by myself, I swear, says the Lord, because you have done this thing and have not withheld your son, your only son. Next verse. Blessing, I will bless you. And multiplying, I will multiply your descendants as the stars of the heaven and as the sand which is on the seashore. And your descendants shall possess the gate of their enemies. In your seed, all the nations of the earth shall be blessed because you have obeyed me. What happened here was that by reason of sacrifice, Abraham unlocked a generational blessing. I know you've heard about generational curse, but I introduced to you something called generational blessing. By sacrifice. So which means that at the point that God was asking him to offer his son, not only was he going to prove his love for him, God wanted him to unlock something. The last time God asked you to sacrifice something you hold so dear, you have no idea what he was trying to unlock. You don't know. If Abraham was told this thing, I'm sure he would have, before God even said, he would have just brought the No, God didn't tell him this part. God didn't tell him this part. God only told him, take your son. Even where he was going to do the sacrifice, God did not even tell him. Amen. You see, if I ask you, do you have any other God apart from the Most High? What will your answer be? It will be no. What if I ask you to prove it? One of the commandments that God gave to Moses was that you shall have no other God besides me, right? Yes. But you see, if God comes to you today as he has come to you now, and says, that thing that you hold so dear, drop it down. For some of you, is as little as your mobile phone. As little as your mobile phone. You can't. It's hard. You hold it so dear. Do you know that an unwillingness to sacrifice a thing is actually a proof that you do not trust God enough? Yes. If there is anything in your life that you cannot sacrifice, it's a proof that you do not trust God enough. For some people, it's as simple as sleep. Sleep. They say, we have vigil. Come and pray. You cannot sacrifice your sleep. Yet you are saying, devil, get out. Which devil? Eh? Which one? Some of us, it's your time. You call it your time. The one that the maker can require of it now, and it comes to an end. Your time. It's hard for you to. It's so dear to you. You cannot sacrifice your time. For some of you, 2 hours away from your business is too much for you to sacrifice. It's an indictment on your trust in God. You do not actually believe that God can restore that time to you. You don't believe it. Praise God. You don't know how attached you are with things. Claiming you love God is cheap talk. You only prove it by sacrifice. Everybody can claim to love God. But the only way you will prove that you love him is by sacrifice. What is it that you have that you have not received? What is it that you have that you have not received? Why is it so difficult for us to live sacrificial lives as believers? Why? Do you know that an average believer, anytime they walk into church, the only thing that they think of is what to get from God? Have you sat down to think about it? Check your prayer list. When in all our interactions with God is what we seek to get. Oh, God bless me. Have you ever thought about what to give to him? Time will not allow us to get there, but I wanted to show you a man, another person who understood what sacrifice meant. His name is David. Do you know what he said? He was going to offer, he was going to build an altar unto God. And so somebody offered him a land for free. Good land for free. Ah, David said, you want to steal something from me? He made a statement. He said, I will not offer to God that which cost me nothing. Hi. Hi. He said, I will not offer to God that which cost me nothing. My question to you is this. The things that you are offering to God, what does it cost you? What does it cost you? We seek to have everything from God, but not willing to give him something of value. Sacrifice is actually a legal tender in the realm of the spirit. So you go before a dibia and he tells you, oh, see, a 17-year-old boy, he's supposed to be in school and grow in knowledge and wisdom, get into the marketplace and start to work before he can earn. But he chooses to skip all those steps and goes to meet a man, and the man tells him, oh, there are certain things you have to sacrifice. We'll come to that part maybe next time. I will show you what sacrifice can do. Why? See, this thing called sacrifice, many times when we preach it, some people say that, oh, we're in the New Testament. Jesus has paid his sacrifice. I laugh because you actually don't understand what the Bible is saying. There are different sacrifices in the Bible. The one Jesus offered was for your sins. It's called sin offering. So that you can have eternal life. So that you can have access to God. But as touching your relationship with God and other things that you need to acquire here on earth, trust me, you need sacrifice. You do. You need sacrifice. Sometimes you look at people that in your eyes are prosperous. They're just doing, you have no idea. You have no idea what they have sacrificed. You have no idea. And let me tell you one interesting part about sacrifice. Sacrifice is not only respected in the kingdom of God. It's also a legal tender in the kingdom of darkness. You, as a child of God, you come in desire to acquire something without sacrifice. Somebody else comes to acquire that thing. He is not named of our God. He doesn't bear the name of our God. But he goes to sacrifice something to his God. He will get it. Yes, he will get it. I'll show you in the Bible. It's there. It's there. It's in your Bible. I'll show you next week by God's grace. It's there. He will get it. There is power in sacrifice. Why are you learning this? The Bible says that, or rather, God has instructed us that this is our year of consecration and covenant living. For you to establish or maintain a covenant with God, it cannot be done without sacrifice. And so, start to make up your mind that this year, the things I've never done before, sacrifices I've never made before, this is the year I want to make it. There are certain realms with God that you cannot enter without sacrifice. Ask Abraham now, let him tell you. Do you think he had not seen the hand of God before that time? He had. But you see, that thing that he unlocked there, without sacrifice, there was no way he could have. No way. Today, we sit here and we say, Abraham's blessings are mine. Do you know the sacrifice he made? You have an idea. I am the seed of Abraham. Do you have an idea what he made for you to be mentioning his name the way you are mentioning him? He's your forefather. Go and ask him what he did. Sacrifice. All eyes closed.